we need in order to restore the vision to the eyes? And she says, Thoth tells Isis, you can restore his sight by putting spittle in his eyes. Spit in his eyes will restore his sight. Have you heard that story before? One of them other stories about somebody who spit in the mud and put it on somebody's eyes and there they saw again. That's an old story. That ain't new. That's one of those universal stories. One of those stories that have to do with something more than spit, folks. Because when we talk about the spittle, we are talking about the substance of the mouth. And the mouth, of course, is the origin of ideas. It's the origin of thinking. We are told, as we get to in just a second, that it's the word that emerges from the mouth. And by taking the spittle, the substance of the mouth, and rubbing it into the eye, you can restore vision. Now, what is this vision stuff? Vision tells us not only what is, but what can be. We are not talking about the vision that just lets us see. Vision is the ability to see what not yet is. That's why the third eye is the eye of true vision. Because the eyes that are here simply tell you what's there. The eye that is here tells you what always has been and what can be. So in order to restore the vision in the eye, it became necessary to rub the eye with the spittle from the mouth. In other words, to bring words to the eye, to the consciousness, to the awareness. And in doing so, you could begin to restore the vision. You had to bring ideas to the person to restore the vision. You had to begin to take the spittle from the mouth of truth, the spittle from the mouth of reality, the spittle from the mouth of the depth of a being, and put the vision back into the head of the person. Because it was the eye that was able to give the creator. That's why it's called the all-seeing eye of the creator. The creator saw not what was, because the creator was operating in total darkness. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad used to say in triple darkness. Was operating in total darkness, and there was no light. But because of his ability to have vision, the creator was able to bring into being all that is out of the eye that could see all. So in order to restore vision to Osiris, he had to be fed with ideas. And then finally we said that the opening of the mouth, a very important ceremony that, you know, the priests try to demonstrate that now, particularly in the Catholic Church, when they give you the blood and the body in the mouth, and the priest goes along and he gives it to you in the mouth. Well, that's another one of those rituals that had its origin in the opening of the mouth of the dead. Because in opening the mouth, you restore the ability to speak, and with the word, everything is called to life. In the beginning was the word. Adam, in the Quran we are taught, was taught the name of things. His ability to name all that was in creation gave him the power over creation. His ability to be able to label and identify and to know what was there was the power of the word. Because the word was the source of power to be able to transform and change and master what existed in the garden. So in restoring the ability to speak, in giving the mouth, getting the mouth open again, what was deaf and dumb becomes conscious, becomes visual, becomes verbal. The person becomes creative and the power to build. You can build when you begin to speak again, but speak from the words of truth. Now what does this all mean? This means, brothers and sisters, that the only way that we can be resurrected from the dead is to be restored in our form. As the ancients told us that Isis was able to restore the form of Osiris. And based upon that model, for thousands of years, our ancient African people utilized the rituals to go along with that, to continue to bring a message to this time, to deal with this event. This event. When Osiris would once again, in the cycle of time, in the repetition of reality that's continuous, would be tricked out of his life and mutilated and dispersed. And the same principles by which you could be assured of resurrection must be reenacted. The ritual of the revival of consciousness, which is done by the stimulating educational experiences that begin to teach people the nature of themselves, to begin to awaken the sleeping consciousness that's there, that's waiting to take charge, to take hold, to master and to rule as it always did. To be able to revive the mind that laid the foundation for the mightiest structures that exist in the world today. To be able to revive the mathematical insight that people were able to perceive from looking at and studying the heavens. To be able to restore the understanding of the heavens and the earth and the movement and the rotation and the transition and the transformation of all there is. To be able to revive the mind that has already solved all the problems that we think we can't solve. To be able to revive that consciousness by simply speaking into the ear. Giving the words into the ear. Bringing true education to the people. Bringing true knowledge to the people. Helping the people know who they are. Helping people know what they are. Helping your children, helping your brothers and sisters understand the power that they have been given in the very nature of their creation. To be able to bring the word of truth to revive the latent consciousness. The consciousness cannot die. The mind does not die. Truth does not fail. What was, always has been, always will be. The only way that you can control consciousness is by putting it to sleep. But this is the awakening for Dallas today. And we are here to tell you that if these words that are being shown and danced and beat on the drums and demonstrated in song and scholarship and intellectual understanding is brought to the minds of the people of Dallas, Dallas will wake up and get out the grave today. And all you need is to whisper into the ear. Listen. The eye. The vision. The vision needs to be restored. We've got to begin to believe that there's something we can do besides what's in front of these eyes. We've got to get spittle. Spittle from Isis. The spittle that came from Thoth. The words of a Marcus Garvey. The words of an Elijah Muhammad that gave birth to an Imam W.D. Muhammad, that gave birth to a Louis Farrakhan, that gave birth to a Malcolm El Hajj Malik Shabazz. He was given birth by the spittle of Isis that came through Elijah. That all of them came into an awareness, into a consciousness that gave them growth to go with. And they all grew, but they got spit on first. They got spit on by Isis, and it began to spit around the consciousness that was already there, and they became the word that moved throughout America, and everything that's been going on since that has been positive and asserted by African people has come through that channel. The channel that had to say who you are, where you came from, what you are about, what your potential is, and here's a vision for you. What is the vision? Listen, here's a vision of rulership. Listen. It is a vision of rulership. It is not a vision of followership. Remember, the people who bought us visions of followership took us to the slaughter. Now, don't get mad at me. I think Dr. King was a beautiful brother. I think all the integrationists worked hard, did what they believed in. But look what they did to us. Look at our institutions, gone. Look at our community life, gone. Look at us trying to integrate before we understood the power of separation. Look at us going to the major institutions, the University of Texas, while letting Bishop die. Look at us going to the University of Michigan while letting Morehouse die. Look at us going to the University of Tennessee while letting Tuskegee die. We don't care about, we understand this is a big world.